Hey guys, Dagan here from PMTV UK with 8 more expensive basses and why they're worth it. If you haven't checked out my original video of 5 expensive bass guitars and why they're worth it from about a year ago, please go check that out. There's some lovely Sandbergs and Fenders and all that malarkey in that one, but it was only 5 basses, and there's a lot more than 5 basses out there. I asked you guys to comment down below what basses you wanted to see, and I've got some for you today. That is very much the same for this video as well. If you want to see me talk about an expensive bass in the future and why it's so expensive and why it's worth it, comment down below and I might pop that bass in a future video. But in this one, it's very much the same as the first. All of these basses are attainable basses from PMT. We can get your custom shop stuff and all the fancy Fender and Gibson Sandberg malarkey, but these are basses off the shelf, not custom made, expensive basses and why they're worth it. And with that, there was a lot of comments saying, well, £500 still expensive, £600 still expensive. So I have some basses in that price range too, some specs and sounds on those guys. Signal chain wise, I'll be running these lovely basses through 2SX cables into a Boss TU2 tuner, then into this cracking orange crush bass 100 with the DI out. It's not mic'd up, so you guys are hearing the DI signal from this amazing orange. We have Fender basses, Gibson basses, Ibanez basses, Rickenbackers and Taylors. And let's start with this beautiful thing. This is the Fender JMJ Roadworn Mustang bass, the signature bass of Mr. Justin Meldal-Johnsen, JMJ to those in the know, an astounding bass player who's played bass with people like Beck, Nine Inch Nails, the Mars Volta, and produced so many amazing albums. Jimmy Eat World, Paramore, loads of them. And this is a signature bass. You've probably seen it in Daffy Blue. This is the black version. They've always come in a lovely road-worn finish. Whether you like it or not, I think it's amazing. People are like, why would you do that to a bass? Just drag it behind a car. Do you have any idea how hard it is to get a bass to look relics properly, like really nicely relics? You can really tell when something's been driven behind a car or chucked down a flight of stairs. And they've absolutely nailed it with a Mexican-made road-worn JMJ Mustang bass. Also, folks say, just play it to get the natural wear. Do you know how long it takes? It's like 50 years to do that, and I like the look now, so I would totally go for something like this. It's a 30-inch short-scale bass, as you can see, and nobody quite makes short-scale basses like Fender. You get that classic Fender punch, but on a shorter scale, making the access to the higher frets super easy, as well as the lower frets. Let's start up towards the headstock. Hip-shot lollipop tuners, proper hip-shot tuners on this signature bass. 41.3mm nut. Going down onto a 9.5 inch radius rosewood fretboard. Beautiful fretboard with 19 of Fender's finest frets. Modern C-shaped neck with a satin road-worn feel. So it feels like you've been playing it for years. It fits in your hand, very comfy. Maple neck, obviously. And the body is Alder. This lovely shade of black. Again, you've probably seen it. Justin loves rocking the Daphne Blue version of this. The truss rod adjustment is down towards the bottom of the neck. Proper vintage kind of style. Custom wound Seymour Duncan split coil Mustang pickups. These things have so much punch, they're remarkable, especially with the little finger rest up here, the thumb rest, when you get your finger style playing on. One volume, one tone, classic Mustang bass style. The hardware is all nickel and chrome, so it's going to age lovely along with the nitrocellulose lacquer. I think that's all the specs, guys. Let's hear it some more. Just for the record, I'm not Justin Meldal-Johnsen. I can't play bass like him, but it'll give you an idea of what the tone is through this astounding orange amp. Oh, it comes with flat wounds as well. Forgot to mention. So it comes with flat wound strings from Fender and a lovely gig bag. It feels incredible to play. Let's turn the tone down now, the kind of only way to get a separate sound from this bass. Thank you. So that's some specs and sounds on the amazing short scale Fender JMJ Mustang bass. That vintage look and feel without spending custom shop money. It's an amazing bass. In stark contrast to the Fender JMJ road-worn Mustang bass, let's nuzzle on over to the modern age, shall we, with this Ibanez. There was loads of comments in the last video about expensive basses telling me to do an Ibanez, so here it is! This is the Ibanez SR2400 in floral natural. There's loads of different ways of saying the name of this bass. Even on Ibanez's videos themselves, it's either 2400, 2400. It's an amazing bass though. Ibanez basses are great because they're extremely versatile. Besides all the electronics and all that, the neck profile and the way the bass hangs on you makes the application for this go from jazz, funk, to heavy metal, and everything in between. Now, spec-wise, there's always some amazing woods and specs on Ibanez basses, and this is one of the premiums, so it's premium woods and exotic controls, or the other way around, exotic woods and premium controls. It's a figured maple top, a beautiful figured maple top, with a panga panga center on an African mahogany body. Now, the maple gives it a lovely bright clearness to it, like a nice snap to the tone, while the mahogany makes it nice and warm at the back. It's got an Atlas 4 profile neck, a beautiful profile neck, 5-piece as well, again with panga panga and purple heart running down it. A panga panga fingerboard as well. It's got 6 lots of panga in it. And you know what they say, the more panga, the better your bass is. 24 medium frets, and it's got the premium fret edge treatment, so the fret edges are nice and rolled. It feels like a bass that's been played a lot by yourself. It feels like an old friend when you pick this bass up. There are KTS titanium rods running through the neck of this bass, 2 of them to help with stability and overall resonance. The thing doesn't move at all, so the whole thing resonates with itself, even though it's a bolt-on neck. You will find this thing just sings and sings and sings. Gold hardware on this beautiful premium bass. The pickups are the Aguilar Super Double Set. Super versatile pickups that can be really aggressive humbuckers when you want them to be, when you want to play some metal, or on the passive blend control here, which is notched. So in the middle, it's both pickups. Blend more of the bridge, blend more of the neck. On the neck pickup, through a clean app, it's got a lovely kind of hollowness to it. Passive volume control as well. Speaking of active and passive, this little switch here turns on the active circuitry. Off and on. And the active circuitry is a treble, middle, and bass, what you'd see on a lot of Ibanez basses. Again, notched in the middle to make it flat. You can either boost or cut the treble, middle, or bass. And the little three-way switch here is a mid-frequency control, going from 250, 450, and 750 to give you different kind of variants of mid-range poke. Runs on a battery. That's all the specs, I think. Let's hear this beautiful bass some more. Thank you. So those are some specs and sounds on the amazing premium Ibanez SR2400, an amazing bass, which the quality and the sound of this thing is astonishing. It feels like you're playing something a lot more expensive, even though this is certainly worth the money you pay for it. It feels like you're playing something worth 10 times as much. This thing is amazing. Now, next up, we have this beautiful beast. This is a Fender Player Series P bass, one of the Mexican-made Player Series basses. The Players are the step up from the old Mexicans. They kind of revamped the range a couple of years ago, and this is the new one in Arctic white with a maple neck. Now, it's not the most expensive bass in the world, but there was a lot of comments on my last video. Like I mentioned at the start, people saying, well, £500 is still super expensive, you know, £600 very expensive. So I thought I would throw one of these in this list. And if you want to see a very in-depth demo of the sounds it does, I've done a video in the past on this amazing bass, but I'll give you some quick specs and sounds now. These basses look and sound incredible. It's a classic P bass, that kind of classic P bass punch and sound, but not as expensive as a crazy American one. You get a lovely kind of rattle with a P bass. They've got a slightly smaller body than a Jazz, but a big old chunky neck. And again, if you want some more proper in-depth specs and sounds, check out the video on the PMTV UK channel about the Fender Player Series P bass. But in a nutshell, Alder body, this is the polar white variant. There's a few amazing colors in the Player Series guitars. One volume, one tone, traditional P bass chat. You wouldn't want to change it, would you? It's a P bass. An Alnico 5 split coil pickup, maple neck. Modern C profile, it's a satin maple neck as well. So on the back, it's nice and smooth. It doesn't get stuck on any tacky paint or anything. 9.5-inch radius, 20 medium jumbo frets. This thing absolutely screams no matter what style you play into it, on it, with it. But again, check out PMTV UK for the full review of this beautiful bass. And now for something just as iconic as a Fender P bass. This is a Gibson SG standard bass. So I think Gibson have got rid of the whole EB name, which is a bit of a shame, but I'm so pleased these basses are still in production. This is the SG standard bass, and it's what we all know and love from these fantastic basses. There's some iconic players of these basses back in the day. Let me know down below in the comments who your favorite EB player or SG bass player is. Mine's gotta be Mr. Entwistle, hasn't it? Kraken, or Mr. Wyman. Mr. Wyman, what a great bass player. Anyways, short scale, 30.5-inch scale on this beautiful guitar. Mahogany body, mahogany neck, rosewood fingerboard, two SG standard pickups they are now calling them, and there's no toggle switch. One volume for each pickup and a tone control, so you can blend them together very nicely. 20 medium jumbo frets on a 9.5-inch radius rosewood fingerboard. Grover Shamrock tuners, the classic kind of Shamrock design. Three-point bridge, the kind of bridge you've seen on Gibson basses for years, whether it be the Thunderbird, the Grabber, or the SG EB basses. Comes with a Gibson hard case. It's great. It's an SG bass in cherry. What can't you love about it? So this is just the neck pickup by itself, this iconic, massive Gibson SG bass neck pickup. This is just the bridge pickup now. Thank you. And again, you mix them together to get a lovely marriage of trebly bridge pickup and thumpy neck pickup sounds. So those are some specs and sounds on the Gibson SG bass. Man, this thing is good. This bass turns heads no matter where you play it or what scenario in which you play it in. It kind of fits any genre with those two pickups. Nice and punchy, but with a lot of clarity in the bridge. And it says Gibson on the open book headstock. Get in. And now for something completely different. This is the Taylor GS Mini Bass. Now this beautiful little thing is a force to be reckoned with. On the line of the GS Mini series guitars by Taylor, they've never made a bass version of this guitar. There's never been a guitar like this in the history of bass or acoustic guitars. It's 10 inches shorter than a regular bass, 23.5 inches to be precise, and man does it look good. It doesn't play it like anything that you will have played before. There is acoustic basses, there's short scale basses, like the other ones are like the cheese wire kind of string. This is nothing like either of them. This thing is the funnest little thing to play that's ever been, and I had to include it in this video because it's a remarkable little thing alongside all these beautiful Fenders and Gibsons and all that. There's a little Taylor acoustic bass. So spec wise, like I said, 23.5 inches long, rosewood fingerboard, 20 frets, solid Sitka spruce top, layered Sapelli back and sides for that kind of warmth and rigidity you get from Taylor guitars, especially the GS Mini guitars. An ESB preamp system. This thing is astounding. It's on all the GS range of guitars, and now there's a specific bass version with one volume and one tone and a built-in chromatic tuner. It's a grand symphony body shape from the lovely people at Taylor, which is a kind of bold, strong acoustic voicing, as well as looking very nice without the cutaway, nice and symmetrical. Mahogany neck. It's just a joy to play, an absolute joy to play. The strings on this as well are only made for this guitar. They're made by Daddario. They've got a nylon core and a phosphor bronze outing, which makes it feel, again, like nothing you've ever played before. Kind of get lost in it because it's so small and it's such a joy to play. The action from Taylor is set up absolutely phenomenally. Thank you, Alex. It comes with a hard shell case, so these basses are great to go straight out the box. Originally they were designed, and the JS range in general, to be like a travel guitar. So it comes with a case, chuck it in the back of the car if you go camping or on holiday or just to your parents' house or somewhere like that. But they've got such a unique voicing and they're very fun to play. The guitars, as well as the bass, that have been used on stages at Wembley, Rock in Rio. These basses and guitars are just phenomenal, and you've got to try the bass version out. It's amazing. This is the Rickenbacker 4003S in Pillar Box Red. Now you guys seem to really enjoy the original 4003 Rickenbacker bass in Pillar Box Red that I included in my 5 expensive basses and why they're worth it. First edition video, so I thought I'd do the S version. Now to look at, these kind of look the same, 4003 and 4003S. Some of the changes are aesthetic, but there's one major electrical change which they made to the S to make it different and slightly cheaper than its bigger brother. It's still a 4003 through and through, maple fingerboard, maple through neck, maple wings. There's so much maple you can taste the syrup. Rickenbacker single coil pickups, the same one you get in the full 4003. Toggle switch, volume for each pickup and a tone, and the little push-pull vintage switch here. Now the differences which make the USA made still 4003S stand out, besides the fact there's only 25 in the UK and PMT have a couple, very nice, is the binding. And there's no binding on the neck or the body. Normal 4003s have a very sharp edge. You're not gonna cut yourself, but it's a very sharp right angle edge with binding on the neck and the body. This, no binding on the neck, so it's a bit more rolled and there's a lot more contour to the body. People do prefer the 4003Ss because it's a bit smoother to roll your arm down, but it's not as aesthetically tuxedo-esque as the one with the binding. Also, the inlays are different. As you can see, it's dots on the S version as opposed to the original classic 4003 inlays. On the big boy, same tuners, same electronics, like I mentioned before, same bridge, same finger rest thing that people usually take off. Big technological difference is there's only one output. The 4003S is a mono output, which means there's only one output. Like I said, it's still got the same little vintage push-pull control. On the regular Rickenbackers, they are stereo out. There's the standard and the Ricoh sound output. They've got rid of that, and this is just a mono out. Still a Rickenbacker though, and this is the bridge pickup through this amazing orange amplifier. So those are some specs and sounds on the stunning Rickenbacker 4003S bass in this pillar box red. There's only 25 of them in the UK. Well, maybe 24 because I kind of want to buy this one, but yeah, it's an amazing bass and a bit cheaper than its full fat bigger brother. This is a Fender American Pro Jazz Bass. Now I just had to use a jazz bass, didn't I? I had to use the big lad, the American made American Pro Jazz Bass. This thing is absolutely astounding, and similar to the P Bass, there is a full in-depth video on the PMTV UK YouTube channel. Check out Sam's video for a really in-depth look at the Fender American Professional Jazz Bass. But I'm here to show you a couple of little sounds and some specs and show you why it's expensive and why it's worth it. The Jazz Bass was released in 1960 and not a lot has changed since then. In the new American Pros, which are the modernized version of the American Standard, I say modernized, but they've just kind of altered the pickups and the frets slightly. Why would you mess with an amazing formula? And they've kept it solid. If you want to go fancier, go for the Fender Ultra range, but the American Pros are the classic American guitars as if they were made back in 1960. Alder body, lovely polyurethane finish, a modern C profile maple neck with Posiflex graphite rods running up the neck to help with the stability and overall resonance of the guitar, because these are bolt-on necks, and when you have a really solid neck on a guitar, the whole thing resonates great, like I've mentioned in other videos before. Narrow tall frets, which is one of the biggest changes for the American Pros, so they're thinner but also a bit taller, kind of more of a vintage feel, and they've got new V-Mod pickups, which are redesigned Jazz single coil pickup, two of them with corresponding volumes and a master tone control. The Jazz bass is one of the most comfiest versatile basses out there. probably on 98% of every record that's ever been done. It's got a slim C profile neck with a satin urethane finish on the back, so it's not gloss, so your hand doesn't stick to it when you're bassing away. A proper bone nut and brand new machine heads. These machine heads have a fluted shaft, which means they produce the optimum break angle going over the nut while keeping the winds nice and tight to help with sustain and tuning stability. A four saddle high mass vintage style bridge, 34 inch scale, 9.5 inch radius fingerboard, comes with an amazing elite style hard case, and this is how it sounds. Just the bridge pickup. And now just the neck pickup. Nothing quite sounds as good as both single coil jazz bass pickups, the new V-Mod pickups, roaring at 10. So again, for a more in-depth look and some slightly better bass playing, check out Sam's video over at PMTV UK on YouTube. He talks about this bass and in greater detail than that. There's a lot of amazing things about these American professional basses. This is the Gibson Les Paul Jr. Double Cut Tribute Bass. And what a bass it is. When Gibson reintroduced the double cut guitars a few years ago at NAMM, everyone's minds were blown, and when they brought out the bass version, it was like, yes, Gibson are doing awesome things again, and it's fantastic. It's a short scale bass, this. It's got a scale length of only 30.5 inches, which means it's snappy. People always assume short scale basses are for smaller people or guitarists that want to play a bass. Definitely not that. Add a little kind of tonal characteristic to the bass, which adds a little bit more pop and snap. A usual Gibson chat, mahogany body, mahogany neck. It just says it's got a rounded neck on Gibson's site, but it's kind of like a modern C. It fits in your hand lovely. 20 frets on a rosewood fingerboard. It's a classic kind of Gibson Les Paul Jr. chat, but in a bass, one pickup, two controls, volume, bass. There's a push-pull on the volume control. It's a single coil, the lovely bass booker pickup. I'm getting proper kind of Thunderbird vibes from this, but apparently it's not a Thunderbird pickup. And a classic three-point bridge, what Gibson use on a lot of their basses. Hip shot ultralight tuners on this bad lad. Cracking tuners, and as you can see, it's a set neck, glued in set neck, 20 of Gibson's finest frets. And the thing, it just sings and sings and sings. This is in full humbucker mode now, and then I'll go cold tap in a moment. Cold tap out. I love this bass, the Gibson Les Paul Jr. Double Cut Bass. It's so fun to play, it's super easy to play, and it's got all the kind of specs you'd expect from something like a beautiful Gibson bass. Great thing, this. So there we have it, guys, 8 expensive basses and why they're worth it. Some of the specs and the sounds on some of the best and the bass. Continuing on, like I said, from my 5 expensive basses video that you can check out still on YouTube, PMTV UK. Pop it in and have a whale of a time drooling over some beautiful basses. I think this is probably my favorite, this one. It's a lot of fun to play, and it sounds as good as it looks. As always, comment down below, what was your favorite bass? What did I play wrong? Make fun of my slap playing if you want. And if I missed your favorite bass out, let me know and I might include it in the next segment of expensive basses and why they're worth it. More importantly, if you like this video, give it a thumbs up and subscribe to PMTV UK on YouTube for lots more cool bass and music related content. If you want any more information on any of the beautiful expensive basses I've been chatting about here today, get your fine self to pmtonline.co.uk or call into one of our forever expanding beautiful PMT stores. We are PMT House of Rock on Twitter, Instagram and Facebook. Give us a like and a follow to see pictures of this bass, but with nice filters on. I've been Dagan. It's been a pleasure as always. I'll see you next time.